small presentation about cryptocurrencies, mostly to just get a conversation with this small group going about cryptos. It's a very new technology still for most people, and with LiboLand it gives me the opportunity to introduce it to the little bit broader audience than what it reaches so far. So let's get it started. I'm going to first talk about my personal experience with cryptos. Then I'm going to have a little introduction of Bitcoin. I'm going to talk about the coin that I'm involved in. It's called eGilder, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit. And then the crypto economy. When this all started for me about 8 years ago, I worked as an auditor for multiple big corporations like McDonald's, and I helped those corporations to pay as few taxes as possible. When I was with a group of people and I automated some process for McDonald's, this basically were my hours that I took away, and this caused me to lose my job, or at least my contract didn't get renewed. And at that time I decided to start thinking for myself. I could either do the same trick for Kentucky Fried Chicken and Burger King, or find out what a euro actually was, because that was what I was really interested in. I had many euros going over my screen every day, but I didn't really know what it was. So I started searching on the internet, trying to find information, and this led me to one of many people that I found out about was Max Keiser. Max Keiser told me over YouTube that I really should look into this new thing called Bitcoin, because it was going to change the world. And when I did that, I didn't really understand anything about it. It was way too complicated. I read it, but I couldn't grasp the idea. But every new episode, Bitcoin came back. And at some point, I decided to risk some of my money to open an account with Mt. Gox. And this is when I bought my first Bitcoins at a price of little under 10 euros each. Since that moment, I have been talking to people about it. And I have, with today's knowledge, maybe a little bit too enthusiastic. So that many people started to believe it was a pyramid scheme, because I needed to find these new investors. But instead, I was just so excited about this new technology that I wanted to find somebody that I could talk with it about. Of course, as we all know, Mt. Gox, or at least I know it, Mt. Gox crashed. And with not only Mt. Gox, but also Cripsy, it cost me a lot of money, and there is a lot of risk into cryptos like Bitcoin. So this is the first warning. If you start to invest in crypto money, one of the rules is you don't own the keys, you don't own the coins. Always make sure that you only risk what you can afford to lose. By the time that Bitcoin reached 100 euros, I wrote a letter to my bank stating them that I have basically lost my faith in the euro, because I have been introduced to this new Bitcoin system. And as a reward for my knowledge that I spread for free, they closed all my bank accounts, which made life pretty difficult. I still think that I should be thankful for this action of my bank, because it forced me to basically move all my money into crypto. And from that point on, I've been living in a way that I try to be in touch with people that support crypto. And this also, at some point, got me introduced to LiboLand. A little bit before that, I went to a protest in Amsterdam, where I lived under a direct democracy. And when this protest was brought down by police, I searched for direct democracies in the world. And this is how LiboLand came on my scale. So in 2015, I decided to pack my stuff and move to LiboLand, where I met Gregor, for example. We had a great summer there. I've done many things that summer. I was one of the organizers of the first sports event of LiboLand. But unfortunately, I got to realize that LiboLand was still a little bit too early to really be living on. It was a little bit too, it didn't mature enough. So when I was forced basically to leave Serbia again, because after 180 days you have to leave a country, I moved back to the Netherlands where I come from, and I tried to start my own country because I thought what VIT can do, I can do better. I founded my own country, Wonderland, in between the Netherlands and Germany, and this is when I found out that you cannot do anything alone. My goal is basically in the end to try to build a system where we can all live without money. I want to try to build a system on reputation, where reputation will pay for your needs in life. I see a different, it won't be as materialistic as today, but this is what I hope to achieve, and by, I think I can achieve it by inventing much more money to show people that what they believe is money might not be money after all. Since Wonderland, I've done many crazy things to not have to not spend money, basically. and after this Bitcoin boom of 2017, it gave me the opportunity to live in any way I would like, and I decided to give Liberland another go, because in the beginning I had a little bit trouble with VIT spinning his ID and getting people from all over the world to visit Liberland with the idea that they could actually live on the land. But if you're traveling all the way from China, it's not so nice to find out that Liberland is a no-go area and you will be arrested. So I, like I said before, I had some troubles with VIT, but I decided to apologize to him for my radical behavior. I have learned from the past. I have been quite extreme in some ways. This is also because my life simply turned out that way, and I am a little bit like that. So anyway, we are here now, and I set this conference in motion to get people together and talk about cryptos. It's not so much about me talking about my life or about blockchain events, but about us together trying to solve a very difficult problem of money. So let's give a small introduction to Bitcoin. Who owns Bitcoins? Just to have a small, if you don't want to say it, you don't have to put up your hand, of course. Bitcoin was founded by a pseudonym called Satoshi Nakamoto. And the trick behind Bitcoin is that there is a maximum of 21 million Bitcoins. And if you compare this to Mario Draghi, who makes 2 billion euros per day, when I first did my first transaction, it kind of blew me away, and I immediately realized that it was revolutionary technology that had the power to change the world, basically. The security of Bitcoin is growing by the day, because every day that it doesn't fail, it proves that it works, and that's giving trust to new and extra people, basically. My own coin, eGilder, or my own coin, is of course like Bitcoin from everybody. We have a group of people from the Netherlands, and I have tried for many years to talk with Dutch people about crypto money, which made me basically very unhappy, because in the Netherlands we have so much wealth because of our oil company Shell that provides food and shelter for everybody, that nobody is in need of a new money system. Actually, they profit so much from their old fiat system that they it's very difficult to start a conversation about crypto money, especially like, let's say, 1 year ago when Bitcoin was still under 1,000 euros. We have a Dutch country coin. I have printed some paper wallets. Crypto money is always about trial and error, at least for me. When we arrived here today, we found out that out of 1,300 supported coins, we printed the wrong paper wallets. So we had to print some new, but I got the right one. So if you are interested, at the end of the presentation, I can send you some eGilders, and free for all to use and do whatever you would like with them. We have new invention in our protocol that is unique for all other cryptos, which is called the Uhu Shield, named after the developers of the shield. In about 1 year ago, we had a double spend attack on one of the exchanges, which forced us to think about our security. The biggest security breach or the biggest risk of most cryptos is a double spend attack. And we have tried to solve that by adding trust to our protocol. Basically, to cut it short, we have made it mandatory for every sixth block to be mined by a known pool within our system. And in this way, we can compete with worldwide coins like Litecoin. We will always be smaller, and with this shield implemented, we can guarantee that after six confirmations, your coins are secure. There is, at this moment, only one merchant accepting our e-guilder, which is bitbill.nl, but with Bitbill I can pay every bill in European or Euro countries. So I am spending my coins for the first time in 5 years. I'm staying in Kamnik at the brother of Dennis, and with some explanation I even got him to accept some e-guilders. But if you need to pay bills, it's always nice to be able to do so with your preferred currency. So Bitbill allows me to basically pay for everything in my life at this moment. There is still a lot of potential, but it's difficult to get people together who are willing to see that potential. That's why I joined Liberland. I think it's a great idea to get more freedom. I think that the EU is a very suppressive force, and I don't like it at all. Potential. Just a small quote that in the Netherlands, with the new year, the Dutch people have spent a little over 80 million on fireworks, and all e-guilder coins together at the moment cost 5 million euros. So we have one of the richest countries, but after 4 years of history, I have been unable to explain them why they would maybe need an e-guilder. I think crypto money is not so much for spending, but much more for saving, and the Netherlands have one of the biggest pension funds in the world. I see a big risk for everybody saving in a pension fund. The age of when you get to retire is has been brought up to 72. When I still worked, that was 65. I always make the joke that at 95 we can keep on saving. So it's just a matter of time until people will have to realize that their money is not really money but debt, and that this debt is not backed by gold but by force. Many people in the Netherlands, I have talked to a lot of them, still believe that gold is somehow supporting Europe. It gets less, but there is not a lot of knowledge about money, basically. So, small introduction. I saw a lot of hands with people who have Bitcoin, so this might all be a little bit easy for those people, but it's about getting people to getting them educated. I'm also involved with a friend of mine who is setting up Satoshi School. He's currently in Cambodia, where not a lot of schooling is, and with his profits he tries to set up a brand called Satoshi School, and we're inventing a way of getting crypto information to the masses. I just want to show you one of the latest blocks of eGilder. It has been mined on the 13th of February, where the block reward halved again. And this block halving, the reward halving, is one of the ways how there is a guaranteed number, a maximum number of coins. So every, with eGilder it's the same as Bitcoin, every 210,000 blocks you get a block reward halving, and because the number of coins that are newly generated halves every 210,000 blocks, in the end you get a total of 21 million coins. And this is the most important reason why a deflation, so it becomes a deflationary currency with this agreement. And this is the most important reason why, if the economy grows, the price will go up. It's you are not able to just print extra bitcoins, unlike, for example, Mario Draghi, who does it every day. And if he needs more, he makes them more. He will, of course, announce it ahead and try to ease everybody, but he is printing 2 billion coins a day, and if he needs more, he makes it 6. Of course, he's telling everybody it's going to be less, but we're waiting for that for quite some time now. So, crypto economy. There has been a real gold rush in 2017, and I want to let everybody know that you don't create money out of nothing. There has been a lot going on in Bitcoin. Don't think that if you put your money into Bitcoin, it will just multiply like that. I'm very happy that Bitcoin stabilized again, and it went a little bit down, and a lot of people were scared out, probably a lot of newcomers that saw their investment vanish, but there is no way of free money. It is all a matter of hard working. For me, the crypto economy is about freedom and responsibility. With more freedom comes more responsibility. So if you decide to invest with Bitcoin, make sure that you know what it's all about. Find out about it on various websites, so you don't just think that your money is going to multiply, but you have no clue how it's going to happen. It takes some time to grasp the idea. That's why I'm handing out these paper wallets to everybody. So, like me, when I first read it, I didn't understand it. But when I did it, I got the idea, and it's by trial and error. So, try it. That's basically what I'm trying to say. There comes some financial planning to crypto coins. The price, as you can see, goes up and down. And you cannot always rely on the value of Bitcoin being what you want it to be. So if you have a high price, you need to somehow either accept that it will go lower again, or at that point make sure that you cash out some of it, because if you wait until the moment that you actually need your money, the value might be lower, and that's why financial planning in crypto economy is good to do. Basically, there's of course a lot of talking about crypto coins. Whether it's a currency, a store of value, whether it's used for speculation, you can actually do something with it. For me, the most important thing I always say is economy isn't science, but it's what people do. You can't give on a. I can't predict anything. Basically, you can't have a mathematical equation to solve the Bitcoin or solve the economy behind Bitcoin, because. What people do is what moves an economy. So I just hope to get more people enthusiastic about the crypto economy and have it a go with some free coins so they can maybe lose them and learn from it. Questions? ICOs are a little bit different than coins with their own blockchain. Sometimes if you start an ICO, you can there is a company and they create tokens. Yeah. And these tokens are from that one company. So in that way, it's very similar, because these tokens can be created every day and they can be billions. But when you have a crypto coin like Bitcoin, there are set rules, like we stop for a red light and we drive with green. We all agree that it's like that. We can change those rules that we are stopping for green and we drive with red, but we have made an agreement that we stop for red, drive with green. So I do agree that if there is a new ICO, it is basically like Draghi printing money. That doesn't mean that ICO is worth anything, because people still need to invest in it for it to become valuable. But there is a major difference, for me at least, in a coin with its own blockchain or a ICO that has been created like Draghi creates euros. So, yeah. Anybody?
You can propagate your coin in South Africa, because I lived there 7 years in Johannesburg, and there is a lot of Dutch people struggling with rents, which are inflation a lot, and blacks and everything. And so, I think so you can.
I have some friends in South Africa who accept it. The reason for me to be with Liberland is partially because I think it's a nice project, crypto related. When I started investing in Bitcoin and I told people about it, they all thought I was crazy. Now this time is over, but I like to be called crazy, so that's why I go to Liberland. Because when I talk with people about Liberland, I feel it's as if it's the same with Liberland as with Bitcoin in the early days. People can't grasp the idea that it might be possible to start a new country because they are so not used to this idea. And in the end, if enough people work hard enough, I believe that we can actually achieve our goals. And Bitcoin gave me the opportunity to live a life now. And I think Liberland in the end will do the same for me. So the main reason to go to Liberland, another one, is that every time when I talk with Dutch people, I get very unhappy about their points of view and the way how they see life. When I was invited in December, I got my citizenship for Liberland in December, and when I meet Liberlandians, as we call ourselves, then when I ask a question, I get an exciting response or a question back. You know, and when I talk about things, the people are so much more open-minded than the people that are so stuck in the system. So for me, meeting people that support Liberland is always a lot of fun, because they are kind of like me, and I feel more at home with them than my orange shirt that represents. Still, of course, I still have my Dutch citizenship, let get it out of the way. I have showed my Liberland citizenship, and in the Netherlands we have a rule that if you have a citizenship of another country, you need to hand in your Dutch citizenship, but they didn't want it back, so they don't recognize it yet.
Is it possible to get tax residency in Liberland?
I'm not sure. Okay. I have, personally, I travel for over 4 years. Every 180 days I move to another country. I don't have an address, and this made me not pay taxes for a little over 4 years now. So if you are accepting that you don't have a steady home and you can move around, you can actually not pay taxes in the entire world. Okay. But you have to move around all the time. They actually have a base in Amsterdam. Yes?
Like, you approach very much.
Thank you.
And the way of life you live. I'm just thinking this question about Bitcoin, more blockchain, because I believe the blockchain is more a technology platform, and Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies are just one of the possible solutions on this platform.
Yes.
And we are too much concentrated on money and profit and asset and everything. I see blockchain more as a media, as a vehicle, as a utility to produce something useful, different to our lives, like Liberland is now doing with all the country affairs putting on blockchain.
I will tell you, this is my first presentation in many years, so I will definitely take it with me, and in the next one I will talk more about blockchain and leave Bitcoin a bit more out. Thank you for the feedback. I think that's it. If we have time, we have a presentation. Oh, we have plenty. Martin, you had a small presentation.